we'd like to do is we'd like to do land acknowledgement. We honor the land as the creator intended, in that we commit to keep it clean and support efforts to make it safe for all. We all can show honor to the native keepers of the land by recognizing the value of their culture, by learning the truth of their history and how it shaped this great country. I am so pleased that all of you decided to join us today. And it is with great pleasure that we have a special guest with us. You know, I don't know if some of you feel the same way that I did or do. And that is, last year, this time, I thought 2020 is over. Come on, 2021. And it came and now it's leaving. And so I thought a lot of the stuff that was going to go away would, but I'm finding myself in a different space. So the appropriate title for our session today, the importance of compassion, the resilience and self-care during an international pandemic, and that self-care is huge. Some of us managed to get through 2020 and began to see light in 2021, or did we? Are we into a second wave? I'm hearing this phrase thrown around, because now we get into the space about emotions, emotions that trailed the traumas of 2020. So what our speaker will do today, she will engage us in a conversation, and we really want you to be part of this conversation. And that speaks to what happens when our passions start to make us feel tired, disengaged, or cynical. She will address the importance of replenishing our souls, you know, taking that needful time off and vacation and that sort of thing. Because if we don't address compassion fatigue, it can negatively impact performance and outcomes. She will also speak to us how to recognize compassion fatigue and how one does recognize it while moving to compassion resilience. And more importantly, how to maintain the critical work-life balance needed to stay grounded. Our speaker today, Elizabeth Guroff. She's the director at the National Council for Mental Well-Being and has more than 25 years of experience in the behavioral health field as both a clinician and an administrator. She has worked in a range of clinical settings, from treatment, foster care, and in-home treatment programs to outpatient mental health, private practice, and community-based services for children and adults. Before joining the National Council, she was COO of a large mental health provider in Montgomery County, Maryland, where she oversaw and directed implementation of trauma-informed care practices. She earned a Bachelor's of Arts in Psychology from the College of Worcester and a Master of Arts in Human Development and Family Relations from the University of Connecticut. Please, let's give a warm welcome as I yield the floor over to Elizabeth Guroff. Elizabeth, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Fanny. So as Fanny said, please, as we go through today's time together, if something strikes you, if you have a question, we will have time at the end. You don't need to wait till the end. You know, just send it into the Q&A or the chat box, and Fanny and Elijah will make sure that I get that. We want to make sure that today's information is helpful and useful to you. So if there's any place where you have a question or a comment, please join us in the conversation. Before we get into anything, though, we want to recognize that we are sitting in the middle of an international pandemic. We're almost 2 years into this. And as Fanny said, I think last year we were all hoping, right, that as we entered 2021, it would be different. And unfortunately, it hasn't been. But what we do know as we go through this generational altering event, that it is so vital throughout the day that we take time to get dosages of mindfulness to allow our bodies and our minds to just decompress. Because whether we recognize it or not, we're walking around in toxic stress and we're walking around bathed in adrenaline and cortisol. Mm-hmm. So before we get into any information, please join me for just this mindfulness practice. We know that mindfulness techniques can help ground us in the here and now, and they can actually help us regulate and get out of that lower or survival part of our brain. Make sure that you're comfortable where you are, whether you're sitting or standing, that you can feel your feet on the floor. If you're sitting, that you can feel your butt in the chair. And I want to just focus on our breath first. And the first thing we're going to do is a technique that's called square breathing. I'm going to run you through two rounds of it. And then I ask that you use that technique to go through the rest of this activity. So when we practice mindful or square breathing, we're going to inhale for a count of four. We're going to hold the breath for a count of four, exhale for a count of four, and then hold it again. And I'll do the counting for you. But just so you know kind of what to expect, we're going to run through that twice. And then I ask that you keep breathing in that way for yourself as we go through the activity. So if you can inhale and hold, and exhale, and hold, and inhale, and hold. And exhale and hold. And just keep breathing in that way. Today we're going to practice a mindfulness strategy that's called becoming color aware. So I want you to take a moment and just gaze at the picture on your screen and allow the colors to become conscious to you. Allow yourself to become aware of the different tones, shades, and hues of the color green. You can notice the different shapes, objects, sizes, and textures of the leaves, the trees, and the bushes. And now I want you to turn your focus to whatever emotions are present for you. They may be positive emotions, maybe negative, maybe you're numb, maybe you just don't even know what you're feeling right now. But whatever you find, just regard that as being where you are. We've probably all experienced a wide variety of emotions over the last week. Maybe fear or sadness or joy. And I'd like you to forgive yourself for any negative emotions that have arisen and to practice some self-compassion, recognizing that you are doing the best you can and that is enough. And now I want you to turn your thoughts to others. Is there anyone in your life that you want to send positive messages of healing to today? someone who may be struggling with events in their lives, with events that are affecting your community or even our country right now. And just send some positive healing messages to them. And then let's take another deep breath. And just remind yourself once again that you are enough. And that you are doing the best you can. And hopefully just by doing this exercise, you may feel calmer, slower, and ready maybe to focus and take on the rest of your day. So thank you for doing that with me. For our time together, we want to talk about compassion fatigue and the factors that go into that, but also the importance of bringing wellness into our workplace and ways in which we can increase our own wellness and resilience. So the first question I have for you, and Elijah or Fanny, if you can share the answers with me, either in the chat or the Q&A, but when was the last time that you experienced joy at work? And you can share your responses with us in the chat box. When was the last time that you experienced joy at work?
We're getting comments like every day. This morning when a child hugged me. Yesterday. Today, last time I was open because my kids are quarantined. Yesterday when my kids said, "I love you, Grammy." Tuesday, I was doing an interview when I went into a toddler room and I was bombarded by hugs and so proud for the candidate to see that. This morning when the kids were having a dance party in the classroom. Yesterday during a meeting when we shared vulnerabilities and explored how to address some very heavy stuff here. One right, it's been a while. One of my coworkers played some music and we came into the hall and danced. Someone said, "Thank you," at the clinic where I work.
You know, it's so important and it's so hard right now for a lot of us to engage in joy at work because of everything that's going on around us. You know, it's pre-pandemic, I think we were already struggling, and then we add in this physical disconnection, where we thrive in relationship, we thrive in connecting with other humans, and this pandemic and our need to respond to it to keep ourselves physically safe has unfortunately really diminished the contact that we have with other humans on a regular basis. I don't think we all realized how much just being in community with others, whether it's in your office or walking down the street and someone smiling at you or interacting with people when you were at a restaurant, how much of those dosages of connection really affect us, because as humans, we thrive in connection and we really struggle in disconnection. And so it's so important throughout this pandemic that we find ways to connect with each other, to have those moments of mindfulness, to give our minds and our bodies that break, but also to find ways to connect. And maybe sometimes it's even in different ways than we used to. Because if we're not experiencing joy, we spend so much of our adult life at work. If we're not experiencing joy, then we really are at risk of fatigue and burnout. We need to recognize that we're human too, that we have our own trauma histories. Bad things have happened to us, that we kind of, you know, like others, when we experience negative things, we try to avoid re-experiencing those emotions. But when we start to really see other people's emotional states as personal attacks on us, you know, when we see others' behaviors as provocations, if you're driving down the street and we get mad at someone because we believe that, you know, they've spent the last 10 years planning to be on this street corner to cut me off when I need to get through, right? We might be taking their behaviors a little too personally. But that means that's something we need to look at. It means we're at a bad place ourselves, because when trauma occurs, whether it's in our childhood and it impacts our lives, whether it's an international pandemic, this generation-altering event that we're all going through, it impacts our beliefs. It impacts the way we see things. And so when our beliefs get tainted by that trauma, we have to recognize that they impact the way we interpret what's going on around us in the world. Because as you can see here, we don't see things the way the world is. We see the world the way we are. And that's through the lens in which we start to look at things. And when we go through significant traumatic events, it impacts our worldview. Whether we see the world as safe and predictable or unsafe in a place that I need to create my own personal control because it's not going to keep me safe otherwise. Whether it impacts our spirituality of bringing us closer to or further from our sense of God, and even our identity. Do we feel like we can make a difference? Do we feel like if we see a problem, I can try and change it, or I'm hopeless and helpless and it's never going to work? Why would I even bother trying? All of those can help us understand how traumatic experiences affect us. We also recognize that all of the information comes into our lower part of our brain, and that's how we interpret things. The first question the lowest part of our brain asks on 100% of the information that comes through is, am I safe? And if I'm not safe, then I go into survival mode, and I go into the fight, flight, or freeze response. The rest of my brain shuts off. When we're in stress, when we're in the survival mode, toxic stress like an international pandemic, my body floods with adrenaline to fight off that bear, and my brain floods with cortisol. And the only thing my brain works on is keeping my body temperature, my blood pressure, and my heart rate going. It shuts off the rest of the things going on, which means there's no logical thought going on, right? And my body, if it stays there for too long, starts to get really sick, because adrenaline helps me get away from that bear, but it can do long-term negative consequences if I sit there too long. And the cortisol, in terms of my brain functioning, can really start to impede it as well. So as much as that's a healthy response when we're being attacked by a bear, or there's something that we need to respond to quickly, it doesn't help us long-term, because when I'm in survival mode, I can no longer respond, learn, or process any information, because I'm in the lowest part of my brain, and all of that happens in the highest part of my brain. We also need to recognize that it starts to look like this around us: fear and defiance and guilt and hyperarousal, or, you know, persistent irritability, mistrust, grief, disassociation. It affects our self-esteem. When I'm not able to logically connect things in the highest part of my brain, then I sit in a place of constant reactivity. And again, we know that that's important in the moment of trauma, but if it's prolonged, like this international pandemic, or extreme toxic stress, ongoing unhealthy or dysfunctional traumatic relationships, abusive, that this impacts me across the board with everyone that I'm interacting with. It doesn't become compartmentalized to that one experience, but it becomes my default for how I interact with all of the amazing humans in my life. The warning signs that I'm moving from enjoying and compassion, satisfaction, and engaging in a healthy way to moving into compassion fatigue and potentially burnout or that I'm thinking the worst in every situation, or reacting disproportionately, or not taking vacations or breaks, or forgetting why I even come to work, or why I even got into this field or do this job, or a decrease in my work performance. I might not be sleeping well, I have increased, you know, disconnection at home, either in my social life or in my family life. These can all be warning signs that we really need to pay attention to, because it is so much easier to see this in someone else than it is to see it in myself. I'm more disconnected because I'm just surviving, living moment to moment, where I can see a change in someone else's behavior. So other things that we want to look for are being aware of feelings of shame. Unfortunately, when we start to really feel disconnected, when we feel like I can't do anything, it usually connects with this feeling of I'm not good enough, I'm not able to do something, so why even bother trying? And that really keeps us in this shame place of those shoulds. I should be doing something differently. You know, there's something wrong with me. I need to be able to manage this differently. All of those shoulds and needs to, and you know, unrealistic expectations, as opposed to allowing ourselves to be human and recognizing we're in a generational altering event and we're all doing the best we can with what we have. When we talk about compassion fatigue, it can fall into some of these different areas. Compassion fatigue or secondary traumatic stress is, you know, where the impact of our work is really personally affecting us. Vicarious trauma is if we're engaging with someone who has their own trauma history and we start to take on, because we've been so empathic and so present, that we can start to take on some of that trauma as well. And then that burnout, that complete emotional exhaustion, depersonalization, deadness, collapse. When we get to burnout, it means that we really usually have to change our field. And we don't want to lose you in the field, and we don't want you to get there. Ideally, we want to stay in this bottomless compartment where we talk about compassion, satisfaction, and resilience, and enjoying what we're doing and deriving pleasure from it. But burnout can happen when we don't have the supports that we need, when the demands outweigh our resources, when there's this role ambiguity, when most of our day falls under other duties as assigned in our job description, as opposed to the amazing things that we do every day that we really engage with and the reason we got into our field. Or if we're not even getting feedback, right? And this can be an organizational culture that really leads to burnout with most of us. We want to make sure that we're not creating a culture that really starts to deplete all of us. Because when we move down this curve to complete collapse, you might see yourself, whether it's excessive expectations or hard work and little reward or increased effort and no results, but also return that rage towards others or mental and physical exhaustion. Cynicism, feelings of despair and hopelessness, and then eventual collapse. We also recognize that there's a difference between stress and burnout, where stress is characterized by this over-engagement, anxiety, sense of urgency, and you know, loss of energy. Primarily that damage from stress is physical. But unfortunately, it's an emotional damage when we hit burnout, that loss of motivation and depression, hopelessness, helplessness, disengagement, and blunted emotions. And, you know, we need to recognize we all thrive where we can. We all come to work wanting to bring our best and genuine, authentic self. But what happens during the day? What are those factors, you know, that really start to tug at us? And I'm, you know, always struck by this small little box on the bottom that says, you know, the rest of your life. So not just work expectations and things that are going on at work for you, but also we have such a blurred line at this point during, you know, because of the pandemic, of our personal and our professional lives. And that's really leading us into a very dangerous place, where we don't have healthy boundaries between things. And, you know, we're just exhausted everywhere. The other thing is to recognize that there's this path that we go on and kind of where are we on this path? So as I go through them, if you see yourself, feel free to share in the chat box. the zealot is someone who's new to the field or a position, and they're excited, and they're going to bring their best, and they're going to make a difference. But unfortunately, as the day-to-day of our work really starts to impact us and the reality versus our fantasy about where we're, what we're going to be able to accomplish starts to get to us, and we're not able to move things the way we want to or address or impact things, then we move into that irritability phase. When it gets a little more overwhelming, we start to completely withdraw and move eventually into that complete zombie phase, that complete disconnection. And when we're there, as you can see by Eric Gentry's compassion fatigue pathway here, we can either leave the profession or move to building compassion resilience and ways in which we can really profoundly change the way that we interact, the way that we support each other, and really the way that we show up to work with realistic expectations and enjoyment and engagement. Recognizing also that trauma is a normal response to complex and overwhelming circumstances. An international pandemic, a generational altering event, is by definition complex and overwhelming. So being in that trauma space, being in that fight, flight, or freeze, it's a normal response. The problem is that this hasn't stopped. And so we're sitting in that, and the rest of our body and brain are shutting off, and we're having these negative residual effects of being here for too long. The other thing to recognize is that how our brain works. So the information for all of us goes from the lowest part of our brain to the highest part of our brain. But it has to move through those processes. So when ill information comes in, like I said, the first question that our brain asks is, am I safe? And if I'm safe, then information passes on to the next part of my brain. And my brain asks, am I loved? Do I belong? Am I connected with other humans? Do I matter? And if I do, then I move on to the highest thinking parts of my brain of what can I learn and engage in. But if I don't feel safe and connected, I'm never going to process any information. It's just the way all of our brains work. So I'll give you an example, two examples of how this can work. So I'm the mother of four boys. They eventually make it into all of my stories. So during the pandemic, my youngest was, doing online learning and really struggling, but didn't want to let us know. And so he would say, have you finished all of your homework? Are you caught up on all? Yep, I'm doing great, Mom. I got this, right? I'm turning in my homework. I'm getting good grades, blah, blah, blah. And we would get messages from the teachers. I'm sure none of you have children like this, would say, not turning in homework, not engaging. So, didn't want to deal with it. He was overwhelmed. He was disconnected. So I'd have to talk to him, and his mom, I'd go and talk to my son. I'd say, honey, we need to talk about the fact that you're not turning in your homework. And my son would, because he doesn't want to talk about it, would become completely emotionally dysregulated. Mom, I don't want to talk about it. And he'd become really upset. Well, the first thing I know is that I have to help him emotionally regulate, because nothing else is going to productive is going to happen. And I can't talk to him about his grades or his classwork while he's in that space. So the first thing I did, because I'm his mom and I know I can touch him, and we need to always ask for permission if we don't have a relationship, but how do I help him emotionally calm down? Well, I would sit next to him, we'd breathe, we'd relax, I'd rub his back, I'd talk to him in a calm voice, and I could feel his body start to relax and calm down. And I'd say, you know what, the reason I'm talking to you about this is because I'm your mom and I love you, and I want you to do well in school. Yes, Mom, I know. I know you're only asking because you care and you want good for me, and I need to do this. And okay, well, so now that we understand that, let's talk about a plan about getting your homework done, that learning process. And he'd become completely emotionally dysregulated. I can't talk to your mom about it. He'd become emotionally dysregulated again. It was stressful for him. So I go back to helping him soothe, calm, just staying in that moment, and then moving to remember I'm your mom, I love you, I'm connected, And then we'd move back up to the plan. And we'd have to keep going back through that because along those stages, he would become emotionally dysregulated and upset. So until we could stay calm and connected, we couldn't come up with the plan. And eventually we would get there, right? Because that's how our brain works. That's our process. I can tell you as his mom, he spent way too much time with me as well. And he would know when he'd come into my, you know, office, my makeshift office now at home, and I was, you know, I wasn't training or talking to anyone. I was just working on presentations, but I've got, you know, multiple things going on. And he'd come in and want me to stop on a dime and, you know, attend to whatever he thought was important to him. And I would say, and I still do, like, I can't right now. I can't transition. Like, I can't answer you. And what my son learned to do was to come over to me and just bear hug me. He holds me and he waits until my breathing calms down and I relax. And then he waits about two more minutes or, you know, a minute or two. And then he'll say, okay, can we talk about what's important to him? Because that's how he knows I emotionally regulate and connect. We all do it in different ways. And it's important to understand how we do it for ourselves, how we do it for others. Because as we walk through our brain, that's how we get to that highest thinking part of our brain and decrease that adrenaline and cortisol that prevent us from getting there. So our brain first asks, am I safe? Then am I loved? And then can I learn? So even if you're having struggles and you're alone and trying to work on a project, even for work, I want you to figure out what to do, you know, what works for you to emotionally regulate. And then connect the project to something meaningful to you, someone meaningful to you, and then you'll find that your brain will open up to really focus on the project and the process itself. But if we're stuck, I want you to look at those first two levels first. And, you know, I encourage people to even get a index card and write 5, 5, and 5. So what can I do for myself in 5 seconds to emotionally regulate? What can I do if I have 5 minutes? And what can I do if I have 5 hours? Because there are different things that will work at different times, things that I can do at home, things that I can do in public. But remember, when I'm dysregulated, when I'm in that lowest part of my brain, when I don't feel safe, my brain shuts off. I'm not going to remember that I like lavender tea or a hug or, you know, a bath. So write those down for yourself. Have that index card with you, you know, so that you can also benefit from this. The other thing to recognize are even just these risk factors that women report more psychological distress than men, that those of us struggling with chronic illness are at risk for more distress. If we're helping a loved one deal with Alzheimer's, a diagnosis of Alzheimer's, or even if we tend to blame others as opposed to looking at our responsibility and what we can do to shift something, can really increase our own vulnerability. If we have difficulty solving problems, then those problems don't get solved, and that can increase our stress, as well as just even lack of resources or not asking for help. You know, as caregivers, we frequently see others asking us for help as a strength in them, and we're more than willing to help in, you know, jump in and support them. We usually see it as a negative in ourselves, and we need to stop doing that. You're just as amazing a human as everyone else, and our brain works the same way, and asking for help is actually a strength, not a weakness for all of us. So I wanted to give you kind of, what can I do if I recognize I'm here, if I can see myself maybe in the cat somewhere, you know, or find myself stuck in that lower part of my brain. You know, the response to those are building our resilience, our wellness, our compassion for ourselves. And so whether we're looking at the dimensions of wellness and increasing either our physical wellness, our social, occupational, fiscal, environmental, spiritual, intellectual, or even emotional, those can all help. And when we start to talk about resilience, one way we can look at it is that mental, physical, social or spiritual components of resilience, you know, whether we're looking at strength or adaptability or positive thinking or focusing on our core values and our purpose, even socially connecting with our teams and our family and having healthy relationships. You know, emotions are contagious. So are we surrounding ourselves with people who are in a positive frame and in a healthy, you know, in healthy relationships. We also recognize that what fires together wires together. So if I connect my loved one, you know, my parent, let's say, and they're also verbally abusive, then I connect in childhood that love and verbal abuse go together. And so how are we making sure that we, you know, are repairing some of those negative connections and really living in and surrounding ourselves in safe relationships so that we can really build a foundation, a strong foundation of resilience. This is just a model from Dr. Bruce Perry in understanding what I was talking to you about earlier, just the way the brain processes information all comes in through that bottom part. As you can see, the bottom part of our brain, body temperature, heart rate, blood pressure. So if information stops there and cortisol floods because we're stressed and the rest of our brain shuts off, that's all our body's focusing on. And that's why if we sit in toxic stress for too long, right, and we don't get blood flow to our extremities or to our lungs or our digestive system, that we have these more long-term negative consequences. And just our recognition that that stress in and of itself isn't the problem. It's when it is unpredictable, severe, and prolonged. That's why this international pandemic is having such a negative impact on all of us. We just don't thrive. We actually become much more vulnerable to dysregulation. And that can sometimes, if we stay here too long, we're at risk of that vulnerability and that emotional dysregulation becoming a constant state for us. So other components that we look at in terms of our own resilience that we can build on are emotional regulation, impulse control, empathy, accurate identification of adversities, and realistic optimism. So being positive about our future, but also realistic, but also this understanding of self-efficacy and reaching out, that when I have this sense that I can solve problems, then I'm more likely to take on challenges. I'm more likely to walk in and say, you know what, the room is dark. Instead of just sitting here, I'm going to try and figure out why it's dark and try to fix that. Whereas if I don't have that, it's like, you know what, the room's dark. There's nothing else I can do. I'm just going to sit in the dark. So having that sense that if there's a problem, I can try and fix it. And I want to reach out and continue to challenge myself more are all components of resilience. And I wanted to give you this frame from the Compassion Resilience Toolkit, but ways in which we can start to really build that. Whether we're looking at our mind and having healthy boundaries, say no when I want to say no, and yes when I want to say yes, you know, doing meaningful work, having the sense of competence, asking for help again, that idea that reaching out is actually a strength, not a weakness. Building in our spirit and our purpose, participating in rest and play and rejuvenating our own spirit, living intentionally into our values. When we focus on strength, we're talking about our bodies and our stress resilience. You know, we recognize that even if I'm relaxed and I'm in a good space, 5 to 10 seconds for information to come in from the lowest part of my brain for it to reach the highest part of my brain. And that's the difference between being reactive to something and responsive to something. Taking a break to say, you know what, if I say this, my loved one will not appreciate me next month, right? But if I take this moment and this break, so important, right? That I can take a logical thought of, what am I really feeling? How much is this really, you know, what's going on? And can I process it in a little better way? And, you know, have time to really react and respond in a way that's thoughtful and meaningful as opposed to just reactive. But also being mindful about, can I minimize the stress in my life? Are there other ways that I can think about this, or can I even avoid this situation? And then the fourth area here of our heart and our relationships, our emotions, recognizing from Brené Brown, right, that we're biologically, cognitively, physically, spiritually wired to love, to be loved, and to belong. And when those needs aren't met, then we don't function well. Remember, information's never going to come up to our logical part of our brain because we sit in that place of stress. So recognizing our own humanity, recognizing the importance of that, recognizing our own place in the world, so important as we build our own compassion, resilience, and wellness. And then other ways that we can look at that, at this, both recognizing that it's hard to see it in ourselves. So there is, from the professional quality of life, a tool, it's a 30-item questionnaire called the ProQual, P-R-O from professional, Q-O-L from quality of life. And it just helps us understand where I am on compassion satisfaction versus compassion fatigue and burnout. And it's a temperature gauge, you know, as we move throughout the, you know, our time together and our lives, we're at different places in this compassion fatigue and, you know, compassion satisfaction place. But again, it's really hard to, you know, see it in others or see it in ourselves as much as we used to see it. It's easier to see it in others. So taking the ProQual can help. There is an app that you can put on your phone called the Provider Resilience app. And, you know, very important that we, you know, we can download that and we can even just take the ProQual on our phone just to get a temperature gauge of recognition of where I am. And as we do that, please do it with self-compassion and understanding, recognizing these components from Kristen Neff of self-kindness, that we are all going through this together, and those mindfulness, recognizing how I'm feeling without judgment. Really important that we take that time. So as I shared, right, that break, the importance of that break so that we can really be responsive in what we do as opposed to being reactive. And taking time to recognize where I feel most alive, most like myself, and what am I doing and who am I surrounding myself with? And when we ask ourselves this, you know, it's so important that we recognize most of the time the answer is in nature, with my family, with those that I love. So how do you bring that feeling into work? How do we connect in a meaningful way so that we can always bring our full, genuine, authentic self? Because that's where we do our best work. Recognizing what depletes us and, you know, what engages us, and making sure that we're focusing our time on less depleting activities, you know, that we don't come home from a stressful day and spend all day talking about that stress and talking, you know, and focusing on it. Because when we focus on it, it continues to exhaust and deplete us even when we're not doing that activity. Taking time for, you know, pausing for just a breath and coping, practicing that square breathing like we did in the beginning. We don't have time for this activity, but definitely when you have time, take 6 minutes just to plan something thoughtful for yourself over the next 3 days, because it's really important that you take care of you first. And as caregivers, we frequently put ourselves on the back burner. We frequently take care of everyone else before we get around to ourselves and feel guilty about taking that time. But 6 minutes for you and doing something really important to you in the next 3 days can be so rejuvenating and so important. Because if we don't take that time and that pause, we're never going to be able to be our full, genuine, authentic self for those that we take care of. So again, I put this in a couple times. I hope you're hearing me as caregivers. It's important that you're smart enough to know when you need help and brave enough to ask for it. And when we talk about boundaries, we are reminded by Brené Brown's work of her braving trust and really, you know, not only having healthy boundaries, but being reliable, doing what we say we're going to do and doing it, being accountable for our behavior, taking responsibility when things don't go right. That vault talks about confidentiality. It's not sharing experiences that aren't mine to share. Integrity and, you know, choosing courage over comfort. What's right over what's fun, fast, and easy. Living into our values. when we talk about non-judgment, Brene Brown reminds us that I can ask for what I need and you can ask for what you need, and that we can talk about it in a space of non-judgment, that we can ask what we need from each other without stepping into that place. And generosity means that when I do all these things, that I can extend the most generous interpretation possible of your intentions, your words, and your actions. So these are some steps also that you can take in terms of practicing healthy boundaries. You know, setting up meetings, saying this is what my boundaries are, these are what my limits are, and enforcing them in the moment is really important that we do. Backed it up with action, because when we practice healthy boundaries, when we're clear about our own boundaries, then we can actually engage in much healthier relationships with everybody. And those horrible musts and needs and shoulds that just bog us down and limit us in so many unhealthy ways. So getting rid of those and moving to much positive, more positive self-affirmations of what you are doing well. So these are some ways that we can just engage in more compassion, resilience. That self-care idea, right? Having that index card with 5, 5, and 5. Taking time for yourself, learning to delegate those boundaries, you know, looking at where I am on compassion fatigue and vicarious trauma and compassion satisfaction, attending trainings, but also support groups and having, you know, those healthy relationships that can help give us that feedback on where we might be and how we're doing. Because when we do that, when we practice it, when we recognize the impact of trauma and compassion fatigue and our professional distress, and we do something profoundly different about it, we can actually end up in that compassion resilience space. And so I just want to remind you that at the end of the day, as we continue to learn different ways in which we can improve how we're taking care of ourselves, because if I don't take care of me, I can't be there for anyone else. If you don't take pauses throughout your day right now during this international pandemic to allow your body to decrease those adrenaline and cortisol that we're walking around in, if we don't do that, then we're not going to be able to be there for others, because the same body and mind that you have today is the same one you're going to have 10 to 15, 20, 30 years from now. And if you don't take care of it now, it won't be there for you later. So just asking yourself, what can I keep doing? What am I already doing that's getting me in that's keeping me in compassion resilience? You know, what have I learned today that maybe I need to adjust, but I'm on the right path? What do I need to start doing? What have you heard that, you know, might be a practice you can add in? And what have you heard that I'm doing this thing that's not helpful and I really need to stop doing it? But continuing to look at that list for yourself can really be a professional growth space for you. And before we move to questions or comments, I just love hearing from the kids. So I'm going to share with you a message from the children.
I get really mad when my brother hits.
Move this over so that you can see it. Elijah and Sandy, can you just let me know, is the child on the screen now?
Yes.
Yes.
Perfect. Okay, here we go.
I get really mad when my brother hits me a lot.
I don't like it when you say you don't want to play with me.
When I'm mad, my brain can get a headache and it can start hurting.
Your blood keeps pumping because you're like really mad. And you start to get sweaty because you're getting really, really mad. And then when you start getting really mad, you turn red.
When your body can't really control yourself, mad just takes over your body.
I just get out of control. It's kind of like if you had a jar and then the jar would be your brain and then you put glitter in the jar and that would be how you would feel. Like if you shook up the jar and the glitter went everywhere, that would be how your mind looks. And it's like spinning around and then you don't have any time to think.
And you sometimes punch stuff and people when you don't really mean it.
When I get angry, I feel it in my heart.
I really don't like when I get angry.
The amygdala really reacts, but the prefrontal cortex tries to keep it down.
When I like feel like I wanna, you know, get really angry and yell, I just like sometimes, you know, like take deep breaths.
Like first you find a place where you can be alone. Then you find some way to relax and calm down.
When I need to calm down, I take deep breaths.
I breathe in through my nose.
Sometimes I close my eyes or just take deep breaths.
Like it's calming down, it's like not like moving. It's like slowing down and then it stops. And the heart pumps slow and then it goes into your brain.
It's like all the sparkles are at the bottom of your brain.
My brain like slows down and then like I feel more calm and then I'm like ready to speak to that person.
The kids are always great.
Yes, they are. And they remind us all the important things in life, important stuff. We have space for one comment, time for one comment or question. Anyone. While those of you who might be waiting to ask a question, you can or put something in the chat box. I wrote down so many points I love this one. Someone wrote, I'm telling people I have glitter brain right now. Give me a minute. I love that. That was one of the comments I wrote down. It's like, oh, my brain is like glitter right now, you know? And the other comment that the little boy made is that my brain's got a headache. Oh my gosh, that's what it feels like. I mean, the honesty of these children. The other points that I wrote down, which I thought was so, just stood out for me, surrounding yourselves with positivity. I just turned the news off. I just turn it off.
Right.
It's overwhelming and I certainly don't watch or listen to anything like that before I go to bed at night. It's just too much. I want to take something in. And there were other points that you made, being able to say no. Sometimes, I don't know. Now that one I'm working on. I'm working on that one because I truly believe this is something I heard many years ago. You teach people how to treat you. And sometimes I'm pretty good at that. Other times I'm not so much. And being optimistic in a pessimistic world. Sometimes when you're around others who feel that the sky is falling.
Right.
Sometimes you just have to remove yourself from the situation. At least that's what I find myself doing. And these are such lovely points. And writing down those 5 second, 5 minute, 5 hour, suggestions of what you can do. These are just lovely things that I can take into my heart. And so my brain doesn't give myself a headache. And I also love the self-kindness. I think that is so important. Elijah, anything you want to add?
Thank you, Fanny. I just wanted to thank you once again, Elizabeth, for that presentation and the video selections as well. I have to remind myself that setting boundaries is very important and giving myself just the mental space to just be and be still is very complimentary and very necessary for just my physical health as well as mental well-being. So thank you so much for that.
Welcome. And I saw a question about the slides. Fanny, I can send you the PDF of those and you're welcome to share them.
Awesome, thank you so much. This was so powerful. So refreshing and so needful right now. So thank you for that powerful presentation. We want to thank all of you who chose to spend an hour with us, because we know that you could have spent your hour anyplace else, but you chose to spend it with us. Thank you, and be kind to yourself and to those around you. Be well.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.